Thank you very, very much for being here tonight. I think we're in for a real treat, a real whirlwind tour. So I'm David Brook, Head of School, and this is our third speaker series for the year. And a big, big thank you to Mr. McDonald and Dr. Castillo for organising this event, bringing it together, and providing us with an evening of external inspirational speaker to sort of set us up, and particularly the concept here was to set us up ready for summer travels, and I hope you're going to be inspired tonight. I'm really delighted to welcome Clemence to the stage to introduce our speaker formally.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for coming tonight on the occasion of our speaker series. I would also like to thank Dr. Brook for possible, and of course our speaker Elspeth Beard, who is currently an award-winning architect, and she also happens to be the first British woman to have traveled around the world in a motorbike. Her journey began in October of 1982 at the age of 23, and she traveled across 20 different countries. Upon her return in 1984, she stored all of her journal entries and documents, and they were shelved away for a while, and it was only until the late 2000s that she began to be consulted by the media and eventually Hollywood. It's a privilege to introduce the speaker, as I am myself aspiring to study architecture, and upon doing research on the speaker, I realized that the mentality of an architect is the same as that of a traveler, as an architect is constantly searching for ideas by either consulting books or articles, but also by traveling and seeking new experiences from people, places, and all forms of experiences. And it's this type of research that Elspeth Beard has accomplished. So please welcome our speaker.
I'm starting the talk today with this image, which was actually taken when I got back from my trip in 1984. And it might seem a slightly strange place to start, but I owe an awful lot to this picture. When I got back in 1984, nobody wanted to know about what I'd done at all. Nobody was interested. And you have to remember, it was in the days before the internet and social media. And if you wanted to get your story published, you had to contact an editor of a bike magazine or a newspaper. And hopefully, if the editor was interested, then they would put it in print. But as I say, there was absolutely nobody was interested in what I did, which was kind of fine, because I didn't, you know, my journey was very personal. That I did. So I put all my diaries, my photos, my letters, everything in a cardboard box, which is basically where they stayed for 35 years. And nobody knew about what my trip or my journey or what I'd done, apart from sort of close friends and my family. And it was only in about 2008 that a friend of mine was talking to somebody at BMW, and Andy said to Paul, he explained the trip I'd done, and so he said, well, why don't you write a short article and we'll put it up on our international site, and with the article it included this picture. So it was. And literally, the article went out, and this picture went viral. It was sort of spread. There was something about the image that sort of captured people's imagination. And so it was kind of shared and blogged, and the story was retold. And I had no idea any of this was actually happening, because I was busy working. So it was about 3 years after this, when my story had been sort of spreading all over the internet, two or three years, that that I was contacted completely out of the blue by an agent in Hollywood who had found my story on the internet and wanted to buy the rights to my story to make a film, which was just completely bizarre. So I've gone from nobody, you know, wanting to know anything about it, to Hollywood wanting to buy the rights to my story to make a film. So I was flown out to Hollywood and I was wined and dined and I met with scriptwriters and producers. And but I sort of kind of realised that, you know, I hadn't read any of my diaries for 35 years. And I didn't really want, you know, Hollywood to get hold of it and make it their story and it not be my story. So I sort of said thanks, but no thanks to Hollywood. And I came back home and then I spent 2 years writing my book. And my book was published in 2017. So it was really a lot to do with this image that, that sort of helped my story spread, and this is why I'm here today. And I've been told that this image has become iconic, whatever that means, which I find quite hard to believe. But a friend of mine about 2 years ago, it was about 6 months after my book was published, sent me this picture, which they took in TK Maxx in Edinburgh, and I tracked it down. It was being made by an Italian company who were getting them printed in Holland, and they were selling them all over Europe without even asking me. Anyway, I sued them and I won. and I kind of, you know, I mean, it's quite, you know, nice for somebody to make a t-shirt of you, but it would have been nice to have been asked, so you can't buy them anymore. So how did it all begin? Well, I grew up in central London. My parents were both doctors. I was sent off to boarding school when I was about 10, and I always struggled a bit at school. I was always I wasn't particularly academic. It was found out later when I was 16 that I was dyslexic, which kind of explained why I found the work so hard. And then finally, I was almost getting in trouble. And I was, finally when I was 16, I got expelled. Was really, and after I was expelled, I was sent to a college in London where I finished off my A-levels, and it was when I was in the college in London, which is where I met these group of people who rode motorbikes, and that was my introduction to motorcycling. So my first bike was a small Yamaha YB100, which I bought from Simon, who was one of his friends. I rode it from the west coast to the east coast. And during all this time, I'd been studying, doing my first 3 years architecture. While I was studying architecture, I met and fell in love with this guy called Alex. And Alex decided to finish our relationship about 3 months before my final. So I found in the summer of 82, I did really badly in my finals. I got a third class honours degree, which was pretty awful. And I was so miserable, I was depressed, I was broken-hearted, I just couldn't work at all. So I did really, really badly. So in the summer of 82, I had a lousy degree. I wasn't sure whether architecture was I should carry on doing. I was feeling very, very lonely and depressed. So I decided, I know what I'll go and ride my bike around. So I started off writing to various bike magazines to see if I could get some interest, to see if they would sponsor me around the world. And I wrote about 26 letters, and with the letters I enclosed this picture. And I got two replies. I got one from BMW Munich, who basically said, well, we don't really need to sponsor you because we already know our bikes are the best. best of luck. It was very polite. Best of luck. And then I got this lovely letter from Bike Magazine, which was the only reply that I got. I'm not sure if you read it, but it says, "Dear Elspeth, Bracken said he'd write this letter, but he can't because his tongue's jammed his typewriter. Julian asks if you've got an 8-foot-tall husband who's also a karate expert. Mike Clemens has already formed the Elspeth Beard Appreciation Society and wants to know where in the world you're going to be so he can get there first. Me, I'd like to offer you sponsorship around the world, but I think it would be a waste and a shame for London." Fortunately, I was not deterred. In fact, it made me even more determined. I was so angry. I can remember opening it. I was seething with anger. So I set about preparing myself and my bike for the trip. I got myself a job in a pub, so I worked 7 days a week in a pub, behind a bar, earning the minimum wage. And at the same time, I decided to buy myself a Haynes manual, a basic set of tools. I completely stripped my bike down and learned all about it, because I knew that anywhere I was going to be around the world, I was going to be the only one who was going to be able to fix my bike. So, and by this stage, the bike had already done 45,000 miles. It was a fairly well-used bike by that stage. And she was 7 or 8 years old already. So I kind of stripped the engine down and I replaced everything that I could possibly think that I could replace easier, like the gaskets, the oil seals, to put the new tires, battery, anything, cables, just to make it easier and give us, rather than having to fix the bike on the side of the road. So at the end of 1982, in October 82, I had £2,500 I'd managed to save, which I knew wasn't going to be enough, and I kind of hoped it would be enough to get me either to New Zealand or Australia where I could work, and then I'd kind of think about the next stage of the journey. So this was the route that I took. I shipped my bike to New York, and I decided to start off in America, which I know seems a slightly odd, because most people from Europe, they tend to go east, but I decided to go west, because I'd been to America the year before. It was a kind of known quantity, and I was pretty confident that with the money that I had, I could get across the States and get to New Zealand or Australia. So I shipped it to New York, rode across America, then went down to New Zealand, arrived in Sydney with about £50 left, but fortunately I had friends there, so I managed to stay with them when I arrived, and I did two jobs in Sydney. I worked there for 6 months, and then I carried on my journey. So I went around Australia, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, across to India, up to Nepal, and then I went right up to Leh Ladakh in the north of India, then through Pakistan, Iran, Turkey, Greece, and then Yugoslavia, and back through into Europe. So I did 35,000 miles in just over 2 years. So this was my parents taking me to the airport. You see, I was rather happy about it than this, so. My parents had a very strange, my mum obviously did everything she could possibly do to stop me from going. My dad was a psychiatrist and was rather eccentric, and he never really said anything. So he never talked about my trip before I left or when I got back, ever. But strangely, I kind of think he was quite proud of me in his kind of quiet way. But my mum certainly tried to stop me from going. I think she even threatened to disinherit me if I left. But I was determined. I mean, I just did not want to spend a winter at home. I didn't want to work in an architect's office because I didn't even know whether architecture was what I wanted to do anymore. So I headed up off to New York, and these were the first few days on the road going across America. And you see, when I first started the trip, I just had these kind of soft panniers and a bag just strapped on the back. And I rode across America, across New York to Los Angeles. And that picture there is a White Sands National Park in New Mexico. I then arrived in Sydney. As I say, I was completely broke when I arrived in Sydney. That's the where I lived for $20 a week, which I lived in. And I managed to paint it all inside, and I made it quite homely. All the furniture I picked up off the streets in Sydney for nothing, because I had to save every single penny. When I was in Sydney working, I heard about this guy called John Todd, and he was Australian, and he had ridden his bike from Sydney to London about 2 years beforehand. So I was desperate to meet him, because in those days it was impossible to find anybody who'd done a similar trip. So I really wanted to talk to him about it. So I managed to track him down, and he was an extraordinary man. He lived on his own, and his house was just full of motorbike parts wherever he went. His entire kitchen, all the worktops were just full of motorbike parts in various stages of repair. And he persuaded me that I needed to make myself some serious aluminium luggage. Because what I had, all my soft bags that I currently had, they wouldn't last in the Far East and India. All my stuff would get stolen. So under his guidance, I set about making my own aluminium panniers and top box. So in those days you couldn't buy any stuff at all. I mean, the whole kind of adventure bike world didn't exist then. So after 3 months, I was a proud owner. It was very stylish boxes. I can't believe how happy I looked. I know it's hard to believe, looking at that I just managed to become an award-winning architect, but I did. So the very first time I met John and went round to his house, he asked me whether I wanted to see his bike, so I said, of course I would. So we went out to this shed at the end of his garden, and just before, and he opened the door, it was all dark, and just before he switched the light on, he said, appearances don't mean anything. Oh. And that was his bike. And that thing, he had ridden all the way from Sydney to London. And he might have ridden it back again, I can't remember, but he wasn't quite, and that's when he wanted to turn my bike into it. So actually, I think I got away pretty well. So after 6 months in Sydney, I had my money, I saved, and I had my panniers, and so I set off around Australia. And for some bizarre reason, I sort of thought Australia was going to be easy, sort of riding into the sunset, English speaking, but it was probably one of the hardest, most challenging countries that I rode through. It was just mentally and physically exhausting. It was the dust, it was the heat, it was the flies, it was the kangaroos, it was the road trains, it was the floods, it was just, and also I was riding sort of 400 or 500 miles a day. So it was really tiring. And these were the road trains. And these things were just literally, they were doing 80 miles an hour, and they wouldn't stop at anything. You had to get right off the road when these things came along. This is one with three trailers, which was all they were allowed to carry in 1983 when I was there. Now I'm told they can pull five trailers. So also when I was in Australia was when I had my first big accident. So fortunately, I'd met up with this other motorbike about 2 days beforehand, and Tom, who was English and bought the bike in Sydney, and he was just doing a tour of Australia, and then Ewan was on the back, just hitching a lift. And we were riding in Queensland on one of the dirt roads, and in Australia, you get this very fine dust called bulldust, and it tends to sit in all of the potholes, so you can't see the potholes at all. And I was riding along, and there's this huge, and my front wheel just went straight into the pothole, and the back of the bike cartwheeled over, and I cartwheeled down the road. And I ended up in hospital with a concussion, and my whole bike was all kind of twisted. And fortunately, I was really fortunate that I happened to be with Tom Ewan. I mean, the ambulance had to come nearly 200 miles to pick me up. So I was very, very fortunate. I wasn't letting up being part of being here in it now. So I spent about a week and a half in hospital, and then I had to repair my bike to get on the road again. And then it's traveling through South Australia, there was a huge storm, and there was 7 inches of rain, which is more rain than they'd had in one night than they'd had in, like, you know, in 10 years, I think. So the whole road just turned into a lake and a mud bath. It was absolutely, and there's no way I could ride my bike in it. So I ended up putting it in the back of the trailer of this road train. And I think we spent 4 days doing 300 miles. We had to dig this thing out 3 or 4 times a day. But we managed to get down to the southern bit of Port Augusta, and then I started the long ride across the Nullarbor from Port Augusta to Perth. And that literally is, it's 1,500 miles of this, absolutely nothing. And that was along this stretch of road that I had the first kind of problem with my bike. I was riding along, and I'd literally been hundreds of miles of this, just nothing. And suddenly all this smoke started to come up from the underside of my tank. And I kind of leapt off the bike. I didn't have a clue what to do. But fortunately, the smoke all died down, and I looked under the tank, and I saw the whole kind of wiring loop was completely burned. It was just a sort of congealed mass of plastic and wire. So I thought, oh, what am I going to do now? And I looked around, and I just looked down the road, and I saw this little blue sign which said auto electrician, which was extraordinary. And so I kind of wheeled my bike down the road, and the guy was from Wales, his name was John, and he was from Wales. And we got out my Haynes manual, and we basically made a wiring loop from scratch, and we fitted it to my bike. Unfortunately, he only had two colour wires. He only had brown and black. So even to this day, all the wires from the front end of my bike are just two colours, which means trying to trace any sort of electrical fault is extremely difficult. But I managed to get across to Perth, and then I shipped my bike up to Singapore and travelled up through Indonesia. And it was really this part of the trip that I sort of fell in love with architecture again. I was fascinated by the buildings in Indonesia, and I travelled up through Java and Sumatra, and these were the houses and this house on this side. I mean, I think 12 families could live in that one house, and it's quite extraordinary. So it certainly reignited my interest in architecture. And same in Malaysia and Thailand, actually, the whole of the Far East was. This was traveling from Singapore into Malaysia. And then up into Thailand, and I absolutely love Thailand. But it was it wasn't easy to find your way around. It took me 5 days to find a map of Thailand, which was only about this big of the whole country. But at least it had most of the towns written in Thai script and in English, so I could work them out. All of the roadsides were just written in Thai script, and I got so lost in Thailand. But it was one of my favourite countries. I absolutely loved it. These were two maps that I managed to find in the northern part of Thailand, and actually neither of them were right. But northern Thailand was just beautiful, fantastic roads, empty. And in fact, at the time, I was all kind of tourists and Westerners were told not to go to northern Thailand because it was dangerous and there were bandits in the hills and you couldn't go there. Anyway, I completely ignored it and I went, and it was just one of the best places I went on the whole trip. Because all the tourists the locals, hadn't seen a tourist in months, so they were incredibly welcoming. The roads were empty, there were police everywhere, which made me feel safe. I had a fantastic time. And I managed to get right up to the northernmost part of Thailand. And then I tried to get through Burma to India, but I couldn't because all the road borders were closed, and I had to travel back down to Malaysia to get a boat across to India. And I was in a little bit of a hurry because I'd actually arranged to meet my parents in Kathmandu in about 6 weeks' time. So I had to catch a boat across to India, and I knew the boats only went every month. So I was sort of riding probably a bit too fast, and that's when I had my second accident, was when I was riding through Thailand. And I was literally a dog just ran out from behind a truck when we were sort of passing, and I just hit the dog straight, it was a big dog, came straight up, slid up the road, ended up in a ditch. And it happened right outside this Thai farm. And so all the family came out and they helped me pull my bike out of the ditch, and it ripped all the panniers off. And I ended up staying with them for 5 or 6 nights. And on the very last day, I went to the kitchen to say goodbye to the mother of the house. And as I was leaning over to say goodbye, I looked at the back of the kitchen and there's this table that had the half-eaten remains of the dog that I'd run over. And I realised, I've been eating that for days. But they were incredibly kind to me. They were everywhere. And I didn't speak, obviously, a word of Thai. They didn't speak a word of English. But they really looked after me, and they were really kind. So I managed to get the boat across to India. This was unloading the bike in Madras. And then headed up to Kathmandu, up in Nepal, and met my parents. And I kind of hoped that my parents, their attitude towards my trip might have slightly changed. I've been on the road for 18 months. I looked after myself. I managed to get two jobs in Australia. I financed the whole trip myself. But actually, they had no interest in what I'd done or what I was doing at all. They didn't even ask me about my trip. And I remember we kind of stayed in this sort of five-star hotel that they were paying for in the middle of Kathmandu. And I had a kind of car park area out the front, and I sort of parked my bike proudly in this sort of prominent place. And they just walked straight past it. They didn't even stop and look. They did not. It was almost like that. They just didn't want to see. Which was a bit hurtful, I think. But anyway, but it was nice to see them. And it was nice to stay in a bit of luxury to do. But so Kathmandu was also the place where I met another motorcyclist. He was the only other overland traveller I met in the entire 2 years, which just shows how different it was in those days to the way it is now. And he was from Holland. He'd actually emigrated to Australia, decided he didn't like it, shipped all his stuff back home, and was riding his bike over there. So Robert and I agreed to meet up again in 2 months' time in India, because he wanted to do one bit and I wanted to do another bit. And so we met up in Agra, and travelling with Robert completely transformed the whole trip. It was just, I mean, India, I did struggle a lot with India. I found India exhausting. It was just the curiosity of the people. I mean, you would stop for 5 minutes and that's what you would have around you every single time. And when I was on my own, having to deal with all these people, it just drove me completely bonkers, to be honest. I never felt in danger, I didn't feel threatened, it was just they'd never seen anything like it before. They'd never seen a BMW motorbike before. They'd never seen one with all this kind of weird aluminium stuff on the back. And then when I took my helmet off and it was a woman, it was just kind of it was almost as if I dropped from outer space. So it was just this constant attention. I was followed all around the place. I had no privacy at all. And this was just an average morning departure. Because if you arrived in a town, kind of late afternoon or early evening, the word would go around the town that there were these tourists in town with strange motorbikes. And so the next morning, this whole crowd would just be waiting for you to come out of your room. I mean, there was just no, it was just relentless. And some people ask me, well, if it was so awful, why didn't you just leave your bike and fly back home? But in those days, you couldn't do that because they actually wrote your bike into your passport. So you couldn't leave the country unless you left it with your motorbike. So, and it was an odd thing because this bike was something that I thought gave me freedom and whatever. And here I was almost chained to this thing that I had to ride home. I had no other choice but to ride it home. And I think now it's obviously great because people can leave their bikes, they can come back home for 3 months, earn a bit of money, go back out, pick up their bike, do another stage of the trip. And it's much, much easier, but when I did the trip, it just wasn't, you know, the only way I was going to get back home was to sit on the bike and ride it. So Robert and I headed up through up into Srinagar and up into Leh and Ladakh, which was just amazing. This was another highlight of the whole trip. It also helped that Robert and I fell in love up there, which was great, and we had a wonderful time. And as you see, that was completely this amazing landscape, and it was very sparsely populated, and it was fantastic. So then we come back from there, we rode back down and then we crossed into Pakistan. And this was a very memorable occasion in the middle of Pakistan somewhere, because it was the first time after nearly two years that there was London. I saw London signposted. It was only 9,476 kilometers to go, so I was nearly home. And from there we had to ride through the western deserts of Pakistan, which to the border with Iran. And that was a pretty tough part of the journey because the road literally just petered out and it was just turned into sand dunes and just kind of half bits of sand, and we had to follow tracks through the sand to try and hope that it led us somewhere. We managed to get to the border with Iran, and Iran was probably the country I feared most, because it had been the Shah had been thrown out in 1978, I think, 79. So The whole country had been kind of completely locked down. All the borders were sort of closed. It was very difficult to travel through the country. It was impossible to find anything about the country. I actually managed to get a 7-day transit visa to get through Iran, and unfortunately my bike was not allowed into the country. So when I was in Sydney, I'd organised my carnet, which was like a passport, it's a sort of customs thing for your bike. And you have to pay a deposit to the AA, which they basically hold as a bond. And then you have to get your bike stamped in and out of all of the countries. And the amount of the bond that you put down is dependent on what countries you tell you that you're going to. And I paid £1,500 bond, but if it included Iran, it went up to £4,500. And I simply didn't have the money when I was in Sydney. So I thought, well, Iran, it's a long way away, I might never get there. I'll worry about it when I'm there. now I'm here. So I managed to get my passport stamped, and then I went into the customs office to try and get that. And I sort of tried to, because all the list of the countries was written on the front of the carnet. So I kind of flipped it over, hoping he wouldn't notice that Iran wasn't included, and of course he did. And he kind of looked at me, gave me a very strange look, and then looked at the carnet and started, pointing at the list of countries. He looked at me again, and I didn't know what to make of it. So I took the document out, and I went outside, and I was talking about it to Robert. And I said, well, maybe he's telling me I should just add Iran onto the list of the countries. Robert said, well, I don't think so. So I went back in again, and I put the carnet on the table, and the guy looked at me, and then he got this pen and he slid the pen across the table, and as he slid the pen across the table he looked out of the window for about 30 seconds. I picked up the pen, I neatly added Iran to the end of the list of the countries, and then he turned back and he picked it up, he went stamp and handed it with a big smile on his face. It just shows you never can tell. So we had 7 days to ride all the way through Iran. The country was at war with Iraq at the time, so it was pretty tense. There were lots of tanks and soldiers everywhere. I got hepatitis as well, right in the middle of it, which was very helpful. But then we got to the border with Turkey. Southern Turkey. I think we were actually free camping on a beach somewhere. I just got stuck in the sand. And then from Turkey, you rode up through Greece, Yugoslavia, and Austria, Germany. And then I stayed with Robert and his mum in Holland. And then I rode back to London. And this was my maintenance schedule, which I kept throughout the trip, because I was very, very good at looking after my bike. I was religious, almost obsessional, actually, about looking after my bike. I changed the oils exactly when I had to, and this was the schedule that I kept of all the things that I did to her. These were some of the maps that I kept. This is my Haynes manual by the end of the journey. Just faintly see a mention right there. And when I got back in 1984, I found it incredibly difficult to readjust to kind of normal life, really. So the life on the road had been so exciting and so intense, and you'd had just problems to solve and things to deal with all day. Every day, and you just came back home and it was just nothing, and I got really depressed. It probably took me about a year to sort of readjust. Robert and I used to see each other. I mean, he found it just as hard to come back and to settle. I think it made us both of us very kind of So this was my bike when I got her back, and after about 6 or 7 months, I kind of needed a bit of a project. So I decided to completely strip her down and to rebuild her. So, which was in a strange way, it was my way of kind of putting my trip behind me. You know, when you kind of clean all the bike and clean all the sand and the flies and I don't know, it was just my way of sort of trying to close the door on it. And that was... So finally after a year of trying to readjust, I decided to go back and finish up my architectural studies. And in 1988, I came across a friend of mine actually phoned me up and told me about this water tower he'd seen for sale. And I was still feeling a bit lost, and I just needed a project, I needed a challenge, I needed something to do. So I decided to buy it and try and convert it into my home. This was a listed building, and I remember phoning up the local council before I bought it. And they basically said, we'll never give you planning to turn it into a house, because they just had all these problems, you know, overlooking, fire, means of escape. And I can remember thinking, but I've dealt with all this stuff all around the world. If I could deal with all of that, I could certainly deal you know, with a few sort of officials in a council office. So anyway, I bought it. I completely ignored them, and I bought it anyway. And I spent the next year and a half fighting the council. And finally, I had to go for appeal, and I won on appeal. And then I started a long project, seven years, converting the tower into my home. So the building is about 34 metres high, and it's a big building. And I think even I sort of underestimated the amount of work that it was going to be. So after 7 years, this was the living room, or is the living room. I still live there now, at the very top. That's the kitchen, which is on the fourth floor. It's basically six rooms. So you've got the hall on the ground floor, bedroom, bathroom, kitchen, dining room, living room, and then a roof terrace. So these are the bedrooms, and because the floor to ceiling height is about four and a half metres high, I've kind of hung these bathrooms, these kind of suspended bathrooms in the bedrooms, and there's the town. So it's about 30 miles, 35 miles from central London, so it's really, really great. And I love it, I really do. I'm sure the day will come when I don't want to walk upstairs, but at the moment. So in 2017, my book was published, and since then, it's kind of changed my whole life again. And I do find it really strange that a trip that was life-changing that I did in my early 20s, and completely changed me, kind of lay kind of silent and whatever for 35 or years, and then all comes back again, and it completely changes life again. This was my book launch at the local BMW dealership, and then this is about 10 years ago BMW brought out their 90-year anniversary book, and I get four pages in it, and Charlie and Ewing don't get any, which is very good. So that's nice. And then I just do these incredible, I get invited to do events all over the world. This was in Italy, which was, 500 or 600 women riding through the streets of Milan. I've been to New York, to Bucharest. This was the Lisbon Motorcycle Film Festival. And it's just fantastic. And it's completely sort of changed my life. And then last year, in 2019, I was invited to join a group of women riding in Pakistan to sort of to visit the girls' schools and to to show, you know, to empower them or whatever, and about and show them the sort of importance of education. And we also got to teach them how to ride motorbikes, which is great. And then this was other trips. I've never really stopped traveling. I've been to Africa, South America. This was Pakistan and Tibet, I think. Yeah. And it's just, as I say, it's just been amazing. The last 5 or 6 years has been great. And then that is just. Last slide, which shows that I didn't get my bike back together again. I still have her, I still ride her. And the towel as well. And then just to finish off, I've got a very short film which was made by Cultural Trip, a company in London, who wanted to make an animated film about my journey, which I think is brilliant, but anyway. When I was on my bike, it did give me an amazing sense of freedom. And nobody could touch me and nobody could stop me. It just sort of empowered me. My name is Elspeth Beard, and I'm the first British woman to go around the world on a motorbike. When I was 23, I rode my bike around the world for just over 2 years. I left in 1982, travelling 35,000 miles through 20 countries. In those days, it didn't even occur to anybody for a second that it would be a woman riding a bike. So when I was actually riding the bike and I was fully dressed in all my gear, I felt quite safe. Australians are weird in the outback. I would ride for sort of 300 or 400 miles with nothing. You'd come to a roadhouse and you'd walk into this bar, and literally it was like a sort of scene from a film. You know, everybody would just kind of stop dead. They'd all turn around and look at you. And in some places they didn't even serve me. So I'd go outside and drink water from a tap. I did find the whole trip quite isolating, and I got incredibly lonely. I would pick up mail every 3 months, and that was the only contact I had with home and friends and family. But then it was great. I'd rush to the post office. It was a really, I just love it. And I'd get this whole stack of letters, and I'd get like 3 months of news, and I'd go somewhere and I'd sit there for hours just reading through all this, savouring all of the news. One of the travellers that I met was a Dutch guy called Robert. It suddenly became almost a holiday from what it had been when I was travelling on my own. We met in Kathmandu. We travelled together through Rajasthan, up through Kashmir, Leh and Ladakh. And it was actually up in Kashmir that we fell in love. Iran was at war with Iraq. There were lots of tanks and soldiers, and there were roadblocks every 50 or 100 miles. We had this ridiculous situation where we changed dollars on the black market. We got 5.5 times what we would have got. But we would go to these Western hotels and we'd be shooed out of the door. No, 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 you can't stay here. As if they were frightened that we would be seen. And a lot of the time we would be sleeping on the side of the road. Some countries I couldn't even get maps for because they just didn't exist. I used to have to go to these kind of tourist places and just get little local maps, and I had to kind of join them all up so I could kind of work out where the hell I was trying to go. Getting lost and finding your way again is part of the adventure. Whereas if you follow a red line on a screen, all those opportunities don't exist. They're sort of taken away. The trip completely changed me as a person, completely. You really are pushed to the absolute limit, and it makes you grow. It just makes you stronger, and you can take anything on.
question then.
I have a question since I have you in person. Can you show again the first picture you showed us?
The very first picture.
I was always intrigued.
Yeah,
what is in the plastic bag over there?
Well, no, that's a very good question. I'm not sure how I, this is not my computer. I can just click that. Yes, so what I did, when I was in Kathmandu, my steering head bearings were getting really loose. And because I had so much weight on the back of my bike, I decided to try and move some of the weight forward. So when I was going up hills, because I had so much weight, my steering it, and I couldn't get any new bearings. I tried to tighten them a little bit each time. So what I did is I took all my tools out, which were at the bottom of my panniers at the back. And then I got this 7-year-old kid in Kathmandu to make these racks that basically fitted on top of my cylinders. And then all my tools I wrapped up in the plastic bag, and I just moved them up and put them on the front of my bike. So it was low down and far forward. And it made a big difference. It made a huge difference.
And I was compared to my aunt because she was working for BMW. And
yeah.
She was the only female test driver for about 15 years for BMW.
Yeah.
I'm sure she would be interested in that. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Another question?
Yes.
Yes.
When you were in Australia and you were faced with just nothing for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of kilometres, did you have a tent?
I did have a tent, yeah. I camped in America and in Australia, and then I think when I left Perth, I shipped the tent home because the Far East you could stay in guest houses for so cheaply it wasn't worth pitching a tent every night. So, but then when I met up with Robert in India, he still had his tent, so we started camping again. So we camped in sort of parts of India and in Pakistan, and then I think when we got to Europe it was too cold. So it was a kind of mix, but I mean certainly Australia was brilliant for camping. Fantastic.
And also, how long did it take the bike to get from the States to New Zealand?
It took, because what I did is I actually in the end I shipped the bike straight from Los Angeles to Sydney. And then I spent the time in Hawaii, and then I went to New Zealand. So New Zealand I didn't take my bike to, because in those days, and it might still be the same right now, the main shipping routes were LA to Sydney, and then it would have gone to Sydney to Auckland, and then Auckland back to Sydney. And by that stage of the trip, I was broke. I didn't have I just didn't have the money to do all of that. So sadly, I had to go to, and in fact, I was only going to stay in New Zealand for about 2 or 3 weeks. I ended up staying there for 2 months because I loved it so much. But I hitched around. I hitchhiked.
And so the bike itself, how long was that on the
road? It was about 6 weeks at least. I can't remember exactly, but it was quite a long time. Because also, when you leave your bike and you leave it in the docks and you get it all crated, you're not guaranteed when it's going to be loaded, because they have to make, they're only going to sell when it's all kind of full, all the containers are full. So I think I somehow found out that they'd got it on a ship, and then it was about 6 weeks, I think. So but the whole, it was a long time. But time was something I had plenty of. My problem was money, I didn't have any money. So I had all the time in the world, so. Yes.
I just used to mine
quite a lot. It wasn't difficult. Eat, clean. I used to draw pictures as well. Actually, if I wanted to buy something, I'd draw a picture of it. But you'd be amazed if you're going to a market, you and buy some food. You know, you just that that to, you know. So, but it was, you know, I kind of miss not being able to have a proper conversation with the locals, because you just couldn't. I mean, there hardly anybody spoke any English. In Singapore, they did a bit. In the big cities, you could find some people, and some people speak a bit in the shops, but the minute you got out of the towns, nobody spoke any English at all. Yes?
By the end, did your parents reconcile themselves? No?
Not really. Well, I think they were just a bit different. My parents were, you know, they were very hardworking. I think their idea of their idea of an achievement was academic, really. That was all that counted as far as they were concerned. And anything else just didn't really count. And sadly, my mum died in 25 years ago, my dad died about 35 years ago. So none of them, you know, obviously are aware of my book or any of the kind of recognition and stuff, so I'm getting that, which is sad. As I say, they were just from a different time. It was really motivated. And my mum hated me. because she was a doctor and she worked in A&E for years, and she saw all these injured motorcyclists coming in all the time, so she hated them. And she couldn't understand why anybody would want to ride a motorbike, let alone ride one around the world. I mean, it was just completely beyond her understanding.
Regarding the roadmap you did beforehand, have you had any will or wishes to also go to Africa and travel throughout?
I've been to bits of Africa. So I've been to Egypt, I've been to Tunisia, I've been to Morocco about 5 or 6 times. I've been to South Africa, Namibia, Botswana, Zimbabwe.
During the same?
No, different trips. So after I got back and I finished off my architecture, and then I bought the water tower, so that was 7 years. And then I had a child halfway through that, so Tom was born in 1990, so that kind of slowed my travel down a bit. But I went back to Australia and I got my pilot's license, and I flew around Australia, and I flew a bit in Africa as well, and I flew a bit in America. But it's all been bits, you know. I've never done a long 2-year trip since. I've had to fit my trips in between working and being a mother and building a water tower and this kind of stuff.
I mean, nowadays, would you recommend that to any woman, no matter the age, but to do the same kind of trip?
I definitely would. I mean, it completely changed me as a person, and I think you learn so much about yourself, which you cannot do really. You sort of have to sort of put yourself out there. You have to take, it's just, you know, you have to completely take yourself out of your comfort zone and really put yourself in situations that you really have to work your way through, and it completely changed. I mean, when I came back, I was 25 years old, and I felt as if I'd lived like 10 lives in what I'd learned and what I'd experienced and what I'd had to deal with. You know, the hardships, the just literally just keeping myself alive, keeping my bike going, dealing with all the idiots on the road, dealing with being incredibly ill. It's just, you know, it's tough. It's tough, but you get the highs and the lows, and that's kind of really part of life. And I think now it's all much more smoothed out, if you know what I mean. whereas, you know, when I was doing my trip, it was very, but that was exciting, you know, and you do learn, and I was, you know, it put me in such a good place when I came back from my trip, because, you know, at the age of 25, I'd learned so much, and it gave me the confidence, I think, to, you know, to do anything. I mean, I don't think I would have taken on doing the water tower, for example, because everybody was, you know, was put off from buying it, because the council was saying, well, we'll never let you do anything with it. And I just thought, well, it's rubbish, of course you will. Because I had that sort of thing, you know, I've dealt with 10 times worse, and I've managed to solve the problems, or get through it, or deal with it, or find a way around it, or it kind of teaches you, and it teaches you to kind of approach things from different angles and think out of the box a bit. You're not kind of like this, you kind of, and that's really important in life. And it's not easy to get that in any other way, I don't think. I mean, there are other things you can do to do it, but traveling is definitely one of the, you know, and it's an amazing experience seeing the world, different cultures, people, how different people live. You know, and I think these days, especially now, I mean, there's so much, you know, media tells us how terrible the world is and how evil people are and how awful people, and it just isn't true. I mean, I still travel now. And, you know, 98% of people that you meet, you know, they'll be kind, they'll be helpful, they'll do whatever they can, you know, they're just like us. And it's just this little small percentage of people who you know, you aren't out to not be nice, but that's the same everywhere. And so I think it's really, you know, we need, especially now, not to be sort of afraid of each other. We need to understand that, and that the only way you can go that is and experience it with people in different cultures, and to realize that they're all just nice people, is to go and visit them. So I think it's really, yeah, absolutely. I think everybody should. I think it should be part of the school syllabus.
Okay.
Your final year, you should go off and travel. Definitely.
Okay, well, it's you, and then you, and then you. You're there. One, two, three.
So
you're the first one.
So when you look back on this period, of the road trip itself, is there a piece of advice that you would give your younger self? Is there anything you wish you had known in that period, with hindsight, that you didn't?
I don't think there's anything I would have that I wish I knew. I think there are certain things I would have done differently. I wouldn't have taken such an old bike, because that did cause me a lot of problems. But I learned pretty quickly, and I think you just do. You learn pretty quickly. You make mistakes. People make mistakes along the way, but you do learn pretty quickly. So, I mean, there's certain things, yes, like, as I say, I wouldn't have taken such an old bike. I would have learned more about electrics, which I cannot do and I absolutely hate. but not much else, to be honest. Not much else. I was quite well organised.
Could you talk about how did you manage to comply with the laws in all the countries with, for instance, third-party liability for motorbikes, insurance for your health in case there was a problem, were you stopped by a traffic agent just to see what you had there? How did you get the visas?
I had no insurance at all throughout the whole trip, nothing. I had no tax on my bike, no nothing. It was completely illegal for 2 years. I think I got insurance in some of the American states because you had to, and because I was young and naive, because that was right at the, you know, the start of my trip, and so I was a little bit. I've got to do things the right way. Well, I learned pretty quickly it was all rubbish. And the thing is, if you're in India and you hit some guy off his bicycle, what you're going to do, some wave, some piece of paper written in English, some insurance company. And also, you couldn't really get insurance then. Nobody would touch you. If you told, you know, if you said you were going to be riding your bike around the world, so it just didn't exist. You just had to, you know, if you had an accident, which I had, I hit this kid in India. Well, she was actually sort of thrown under my wheel, but that's another story. The father just wanted money. He didn't care, you know, he just wanted money. So you just pay them, and then that's it. So insurance is irrelevant. You just, medical insurance. I did have, as part of the trip, I had this SOS medical insurance, which was supposed to repatriate you back to your country if you need, but it didn't. It was pretty useless. So. I was stopped by lots of planes. But they don't know what they're looking at. You know, they haven't got a clue what they're looking at. I mean, they're just these. I mean, you know, people say, oh, there's all these good people, you know, in wearing these uniforms. I always used to call them costumes. Because they're just, you know, and they didn't have a clue what they were looking at. So. But you just have to keep going, you know, you can't worry about. And you pay them. These bribes. When we were trying to get out of India, and they stopped us from getting out of India, and then they kind of indicated that they'd let us out of India if we had a Playboy magazine. But we didn't have one. So we were sent back. It's a different world.
Yes.
Yes.
You described the part of the trip where you traveled with Robert as the vacation, was the term you used.
Yeah.
I don't know how you describe the other part, but it seems like you traveled mostly by yourself.
Yeah.
So what, presumably that's something important.
It was just traveling alone. It's just very lonely, to be honest. It's lonely and it's hard work. You know, you have to make all the decisions yourself. Any problems you have to solve yourself. You've got nobody to discuss it with. If you're ill, you've got to look after yourself. Well, that's actually quite hard. I mean, I can remember I got ill. I can't remember where it was. And I was lying in this tent. I couldn't, you know, I had no water. There was nobody I could send out to get me water or could look after me or could feed me. You know, you're completely alone.
You decided to travel by yourself, so you...
Well, I did, because I wanted to do the trip, and there was nobody I could find. I mean, I didn't set out to do it on my own. It wasn't, I'm doing it alone. It was just sort of, there was nobody that I knew at home that wanted to do it, and I did want to do it. I wasn't.